Ready to go. Okay, good afternoon, everybody. My name is Stefano Tempesta. This is my third Ignite, actually, considering New Zealand the fourth one. But it's the first time I present a session in an arena. I think the popularity may be because someone has got misled by the word spaghetti in the title. I just want to make sure that everybody is on the same page. This is not a cooking class, okay? All right, so we're going to talk about IT stuff, microservice architecture, and a few other things in Azure. All right, said that, agenda for today. Well, let's start a journey. It's a journey that I'm part of it in my current organization, my current company. As I started, we had a few challenges around scalability performance of what we typically classify as a monolith application. And as we are evolving into more a microservice architecture, more of scalability, I'll go through this step by step. One of the first steps is the Enterprise Service Bus, the publish-subscribe pattern. Is that a good way to address kind of spaghetti architecture, or there are better ways? And then we spend more time also on the service fabric, try to understand how it can help leveraging and deploying microservice architecture. Before we jump into the content of this session, just 1 minute about myself. So I'm a professional football player for FC Barcelona. All right, this one didn't go very well. In Europe, it went much better. All right, okay. Probably I should have said the soccer. All right, okay. I'm an MVP candidate for SharePoint and chapter leader for CRM Saturday for Italy and Switzerland. Don't ask why SharePoint and Dynamics CRM, a match made in heaven. Italy because I'm from Italy, and that's the connection with spaghetti. And Switzerland because it's there where I live now. And what is beautiful about Switzerland? Small country in the mountains. Lakes, skiing resort. Someone said cheese. Someone else said secret bank account. Okay, I'd say chocolate, all right? So chocolate is one of the key products of Switzerland. You guys help yourself and go around. And it's one of the finest chocolate in Switzerland. I live just 5 minutes from the factory. Enough with the promotion, I'm not paid for it. Let's move on. All right, so I work for EF Education First. It's an organization that has been in the business for over 50 years. And obviously, there is a bit of legacy. Legacy in terms of IT, in terms of context of applications. And as we start growing our business, we add a few challenges in terms of how we scale to new markets, to support new businesses. Applications are like our CRM to support sales, or our school management system. You know, our business is on delivering training courses, so schools that manage students and teachers and all the traveling of students to a different location, so on. So when I joined this organization, I found a very complex architecture made of different systems. There is a CRM, as said, to support our sales. There is a website, ef.com, for managing all the expression of interest, the marketing part of it. Several mobile apps that are for students, for instructors, for parents as well. System for communications via SMS, email, a kind of ERP for managing assets in the school, a data warehouse, and so on. And all of them talk to each other, which is good, obviously, so they don't live in isolation. So you start having the CRM consuming some APIs. For example, we have an API for weather forecast, so we can inform the student at destination that there is or there is not good weather, so they can prepare themselves. From the website, we receive expression of interest in the range of 1,000 every day, so they go into the CRM and create a lead. You know, and then the data warehouse is regularly populated with data coming from different applications, and then we obviously communicate through the API to mobile apps, and so on. We send SMS, we send emails. No, I start getting the picture. I start getting kind of a complex scenario where you have all the dependency. And don't think that is just a call to an API. You know, that would be a very modern setup, a modern infrastructure in some way. Some of them are flat files. Some are dumped into a shared drive and synced every 24 hours. There is even an FTP server for sending evaluation that are scanned and then uploaded through a PDF in an FTP server. So all of these connections are actually different technologies, different different patterns of integration as well, with challenges around performance, with challenges around security. All of them is breakable. All of them represent a security vulnerability. So we need to make sure that our APIs run on HTTPS, they are all authenticated, the FTP server is a secure FTP server, and all these concern. So as we grow into this intricate connection, you start realizing that this looks exactly like this, right? And I cooked myself to take a picture for the conference. And, you know, is that wrong? Is there a better way of doing it? And no, don't get me wrong, I'm not saying that spaghetti coding is or architecture is necessarily wrong. I mean, being Italian myself, I obviously appreciate spaghetti. But in IT, is there a better way of doing it? Well, it's interesting because microservices now obviously start getting a bit of traction, and there are a lot of examples, you know, like Netflix and other organizations that are running towards a more microservice distributed architecture. And I don't know if you heard about the concept of the diagram of the Death Star. It's basically something like this. Something that connects all the thousands and thousands of microservices. This is actually exactly from Netflix, among them, showing how intricate they are. It's not meant to be clear, it cannot be, but in a nutshell, there are thousands and thousands of connections between all the services. And this, again, looks like a very intricate, complicated structure among all the services. So, now the question again, are spaghetti good or wrong? And are microservices a good or a wrong way of resolving these challenges? And the answer is part of the journey that I started and I'm sharing the experience. We ended up with not necessarily a conclusion, because it's a journey, we're still in progress, but having some challenges in breaking the monolith into different pieces, because legacy application, .NET, WPF, so not only web application, but also desktop, Windows desktop thin clients, and breaking this down into different services that can be deployed into a separate infrastructure is a challenge. So there are opportunities to improve the connections between the integration between all the points, but not necessarily going towards a pure scalable or distributed architecture. It's a journey. This journey starts with the concept of an enterprise service bus. I want to go step by step towards the microservice architecture to see how we evolved into this into this digital transformation. Enterprise service bus is a very solid concept of patterns in enterprises that basically remove the complexity or try to remove the complexity of the integrations. As you see in this diagram, simplified, there are the 8 applications that we already have in the system that you have seen in the previous slide, but now they're not connected to each other. So we don't have dozens and dozens of point-to-point connections. We actually have all of the applications talking to an enterprise service bus. And you know, removing or updating or securing one of these points is much, much simpler. Because now we have one point of authentication or one point of conversion of all the messages, which is basically, as an enterprise service bus, providing the messaging, so the possibility to send a signal and then receive the signal and propagate the signal into the bus to another endpoint that is listening, so is publishing the message, and then someone is subscribed and is listening to the message to receive. There is a process or a mechanism of queuing, so the message is not lost, and you know, if you have a point-to-point connection to an API and the third-party service is not available, you end up not being able to connect to the service or to invoke the API itself. So you lose connectivity. The Enterprise Service Bus offers that queuing or that caching capability. It offers also security, as I said. That little triangle up there is a kind of a funnel which basically filters the messages. Only applications that are subscribed to receive specific messages are able to receive the message indeed. And then there is a possibility to create a workflow, so a sequence of steps that can go one after the other one. So it is a pattern that has been around for some time and has helped us to remove some of the complexity of the point-to-point integration. Now, what I want to show you here on a live demo is, let me see if this works. Here we go. How this can be implemented in Azure Service Bus, and doing a bit of simple C# coding to connect to the Service Bus. So the Service Bus is an implementation. The Azure Service Bus is an implementation of this pattern of publishing and subscribing applications that basically works at two levels. A level of a queue. It's visible enough, otherwise I zoom in a bit. It works a level of a queue, so there is a queue that I call ratings. We'll see why in a moment. And it works as topics. So the difference is, excuse me, the queue is simply providing queuing mechanism. I send a message, the message is in the queue. As a third-party application or a separate endpoint, I just look into the queue, the message that is available, I take it and I process it. It's a simple FIFO, F-I-F-O mechanism, which basically provides reliability of dispatching of the messages. It's still not a publish subscribe pattern, but let's go in order. Let's see how this can be implemented in C# in a web application. So the application is something like this. Let me just open it very briefly in a browser. I'm just pretending to do a rating. So this, I think, is session 435, if I'm not wrong. And I'll give a vote of 4. Create. Can do it. And this is sending the message to the queue. Taking some time. Must be something with the connection. I'm connected. Let me check in. Beautiful. Okay. All right. So if I go into the queue, I don't know if it arrived, but let me just double check. If I go into the queue, message not arrived. All right, let's give it a minute in case is the communication over internet is hanging a bit. Let's see how this is implemented. This is an MVC application. It can be anything, honestly, but just to make it simple, I create an MVC application. There is a controller, and this controller, when I click create, it will generate a new rating. Rating is a simple model. I kept everything simple, item and vote. Now, one is all asynchronous. That's the model of the Enterprise Service Bus. And then it will post the model to my rating client. What is my rating client is basically the connection, the client connection to the queue. And the way I do is a very simple HTTP client is sending a post in JSON, and then it's just delivering this to a web API. So if now we go into the web API itself, the web API has obviously a post command for the rating object. It will serialize in JSON, and it will send through a broker message, not a broken, a brokered message, to the queue. So there are two ways of connecting. Let's go in order. So forget this for now. Is the queue client is what you need to connect to this queue in Azure. It will create a queue from a connection string that you have defined into your web config. So zoom out a bit, zoom in a bit. Define your service box connection string, your endpoint, your access key, and the password, basically. And then connect, obtain a reference to the queue client, and then send a broker message to the queue itself. Once this is done, and let me see if I refresh a bit, if this has received the message. Strange, message not received yet. Okay, funny. The message then is ready in the queue to be extracted by a third-party application. In my case, that would be another application that I've developed here. Is, let's pretend there is a fake CRM. Yeah, the problem is now that there is no message in the queue, so it will not come out. But this fake CRM is basically consuming the queue from the other side of the bus. Okay, there is no message in the queue for some reason, but going into the application itself, when I click the refresh here, it will basically connect to the queue client again, obtain a message. So when a message is in the queue, it will obtain the object itself, deserialize, and then add to my CRM. This now is doing some calculation about doing some average rating. Is not really important for now. But what is all this about is basically, let me see if I can push this again. Interesting, it's not going. Okay. I'm connected. I'll just double checking if there is very quickly in case I'm doing something wrong. But this is a I'm not enjoy. Thank you. Okay. Let me double check that. Can be actually a very good point, because I started all the services, but I probably didn't start the API. Okay, well, expected, but at least it's running. So let me go here again, create. Ah, double chocolate for you. Okay. So let me refresh this now. And see if we have anything in the queue. I don't really see a message here. There should be a message. Okay. And if I go to the here, ah no, it's coming. Okay. It popped out, excellent, okay. So the two applications have talked to each other, and if I switch briefly here, just to summarize, my web application in this case, where you enter your rating, has sent a message. The message ended into the Azure service bus, into a specific queue, and then the CRM just looked into the queue when the message was received. It just processes the message and display on screen. Obviously, the CRM can do some additional logic. Now, this is a way of making two applications talk to each other through a middle layer. It's still not a proper publish-subscript pattern because it's more reacting to an event. A message is in the queue. The queue is then looked after by any of the applications, and then the message processed. What the service bus can do is actually provide a mechanism for subscribing application to a specific queue, or better, a topic. So the way it works is similar. It's just that instead of having a queue, we create a topic. Wrong button. This one, yeah. We create a topic. Inside the topic, we have different applications that we can subscribe. So there are no subscriptions here. All right. So let's subscribe my fake CRM. And that's it. I'll create my subscription. Take less than a minute. Here we go. Subscription created. So now I have a fake CRM as an application subscribed to receive messages in the service bus. What the change at code level? Very simple. Actually, it's absolutely the same mechanism that we have seen before. The only difference is from a client perspective, there are no differences. I'm still posting to my web API. And this already giving me an advantage because in every time in my spaghetti connection, I want to make a change to the message that I send or to the quality in terms of security, in terms of performance of the integration, the technology itself, I will need to make a change on both points. In this way, I'm sending a message. And then the way it is processed is specific to the service bus. So I'm not changing anything to the client. The only change that I have to do is at API level. Instead of using a queue client, I need to use a topic client. It will just be as simple as that. I'll comment this out and put this in the loop. And as you see, it's very similar. I'm just using a topic client. Send a broker message, similar syntax here before. This one is duplicate code for some reason. Here we go. And then send the message asynchronous. Two lines of code. How can it be so beautiful? All right, so now let me run this again. This topic, client. Yes, ratings topic is correct. Let me double check in the portal. It is, yes, it is ratings topic, it's not case sensitive. So it should be all right. Let's give it a try. And from an application perspective, so from the CRM that received the message, instead of looking into the Q client, it will have to look into the you will have to look into the topic. So it is also a little change because why things are changing without me noticing? Sorry. Here we go. And is the refresh message is a similar approach when there is a message do something. So when there is a message in the subscription client do something, which is basically get the object from the topic and then deserialize. The only difference is that we have a message complete here, which is basically informing the bus that I'm done with processing this message and you can remove it from this specific subscription. So the way it basically here is that the message now will go into the topic, which is still a queue. It will be specific to all the applications that are subscribed. So, in the normal queue, it will be removed by the first application that extracted from the queue. In a subscription model, it will be specific to every application that is subscribed. Now, this subscription is called fake CRM, and I have to specify here in my subscription what is the name of the application. So when I define my subscription client, it will still have a connection string. It will still have the topic name, which is what we said here, ratings topic, but also to specify what is the subscription name. Now there are two ways of looking into, let me zoom in a bit, to receive messages, the pick, lock, and the receive and delete. The pick lock, you have to explicitly say remove it. The receive and delete will do it for you. The default value is pick lock, though. So we keep it as it is. But because it is a pick lock, then if we don't need a message any longer, we need to explicitly say to complete. So it will be removed from the subscription. All righty, so let's see if that works. I'll close a few browser and start again. So the API should run. I run my web app, which I haven't changed. Okay, and I run also my fake CRM. And I'll try to send the same message now, so I can opening the same browser. Okay, all right, I'll take this. So I can send the same message. It's opening the same browser here. All right, but now this time, so last I voted four before. This time we are doing topic, so in more advanced, get five. And okay, this has been submitted. Now we go into the fake CRM and see if anything has changed. In the meanwhile, let me just refresh this page and see if we have a message, rating topics. Come on, Azure. Okay. Sometimes the portal and I have conflicts. Here we go. Okay, so there is a message here in the fake CRM subscription. So the message is there. Happy to see that. If I refresh, let's see what happens. Yeah. Here we go. Got total count 2, is doing an average. It was 4 before, 5, 4.5, and that this business logic in the CRM, nothing to do with enterprise service bus. The bus has only dispatched messages. This is a bit of a business logic that is in the CRM itself. But that's actually a good point, which brings me to present, to discuss a bit what are some of the challenges of this publish-subscribe pattern, or in general of an enterprise service bus. And what I noticed is that typically when this application like BizTalk or Scribe Insight, all these service bus are introduced in an enterprise, people tend to put a lot of business logic in that, which is not the right place to do it. Then we are basically moving the complexity from the client application into a centralized repository, which the enterprise service bus is, and easily end up in just aggregating all the information into one central middle layer. This is an anti-pattern. This is why, let's say, modern application based on microservices and the service fabric that we'll introduce in a moment help us to deploy are going against the concept of an enterprise service bus. I have seen a lot of times situations where you need to apply some form of, say, a discount to an order. This is done in the enterprise service bus, because the service bus, like, you know, again, BizTalk or any other players, they do provide capability for doing some logic. This can be even coding, C#, or can be data transformation, data mapping. Data mapping is still okay if you're actually mapping field to field or doing some simple transformation, say, from an Excel to a JSON message or from a CSV file to an XML file. The real challenge becomes when that transformation is not only purely for transferring the message to another endpoint, but it actually includes some logic. You know? As in this case, the my fake CRM received two messages and has calculated the average vote and presented on screen. That is done into the CRM. If it was in the service bus, then it would represent a limitation to the possibility to scale the architecture to a microservice structure. Why is that? Okay, it is because aggregating logic into one container, into one application, generates what is called a monolith. And a monolith doesn't scale. Service fabric, so we'll jump into the next topic, is something that helps us to scale because implements or facilitates the implementation of some of the concept that you see on screen now. The command query responsibility segregation pattern and event sourcing is not necessarily tied to service fabric. It's not necessarily an attribute of a microservice architecture, but it's a design pattern that helps distributing application in a way that they can scale separately, node by node, and service fabric helps in doing this. We'll have a look in a moment. In service fabric, you can deploy stateless service, your web API, but you can also do stateful services, so services that have a memory of what is your data, what is your messages. So you can implement a queue, for example. And Service Fabric, at the end, is infrastructure. It's a collection of containers, but offered as a platform. So instead of dealing with the configuration of the networking, with the configuration of the security, with the configuration of each node in a cluster, Service Fabric comes out of the box as a cluster of nodes with an automatic distribution of services on each node So the entire life cycle of the application is taken care automatically by this platform. It is the infrastructure at the end. So there are a lot of containers that are used and are deployed, but it is done in a kind of transparent way. Most of the services in Azure, like DocumentDB, Power BI, the IoT Hub, are actually based on Service Fabric. So it is that level before the platform, but beyond or after the infrastructure. It's the glue between infrastructure and platform as a service. All right, so why the CQRS, and be careful how to pronounce it, because CQRS doesn't sound very nice. So is a pattern that facilitates the distribution of application. I want to just show you very briefly, I'm not going too much into the detail of it, and because you know, it will take a lot of time to play with the CQRS. And just put the same slide on screen, then we'll jump into the code. There was a very nice session yesterday by Richard Bank about CQRS. So if you missed it, watch it on the recording, because it goes really into the details of the implementation of these patterns, some advantages, why, what to do and what not to do. But very briefly, I just want to go through some of the key aspect of it, because it will help us to understand the capability of distributing these applications over Service Fabric. So let's start from the application again. So, if I go here, I have a web application, which is, again, a very simple MVC application that we have started building in our organization, where you basically have a dashboard of all emergency events that have been that have occurred in some schools, so sub-emergency events. And when an emergency event occurs, so when it's generated, I want to create a list of people that I allocate and dispatch to verify if all the students are safe or not. We will not go into all the end-to-end application itself, but just very briefly, I create a new event. Say there is a bushfire in Gold Coast. Today is the 16th of February. Status active. Okay, is in San Diego, so it's not in Gold Coast, because I don't have Gold Coast in the list of schools. And then San Diego Beach. And I can create, should take my name automatically, bushfire in San Diego, here it is. All right, okay, so this is just a dashboard. I create an event, the event is saved into my database, fair enough. But how I am implementing this through the CQRS pattern? All right, so let's have a look. I'll switch between this slide and the code, so I don't have to go through the switch here. The pattern basically says, as a controller, so as a person or as a system or as a service that starts a process, send a command. That command, in our case, was create the emergency event. That command, though, is not processed immediately, but is processed through a queue, a command bus. So that is the first change to the normal, so to speak, way of designing application. Typically, in a software application, a person in this case, creates the event, and the event is immediately processed. Now we are introducing a way of doing actions asynchronously. That is the first element of scalability, going asynchronous. And then we are also doing through a queue, which introduce reliability, so guarantee of delivery of the message. who is processing this queue is a command handler. So let's have a look into this first step first before we go into the event sourcing. So this is my controller. I'm in an MVC application, is an MVC controller. I have an action here. And if you're used to work with Entity Framework or the MVC scaffolding of Visual Studio, typically you have index, create, edit, delete, all the CRUD operations, no? To create, read, and edit and delete a record, an item. Now, this pattern forces you to think of commands, of actions, rather than of CRUD operations. So your MVC actions in the controller actually reflect the name of the activity, the command that you're doing. So it's a create a new emergency event. That's the name. And what is happening, so let's go into the post, so when the command is actually executed. Here it is. I'm adding a new object to the command bus. So first of all, what is the object itself? The object identifies the command. And if I dig into it, actually, if I can do it like this, is even better. Here we go. If I dig into it, my command has some attributes that specify what is the event, and the event, again, if I dig into it, is a collection of properties that defines the name, the start date, the status, the affected school, and so on. Some other properties specific of the command, but at the end, as you can see, is a POCO class, is a plain C# object. So what is happening here is creating an instance, putting some properties, some values into the properties, the event, the created by, the created on, with what I pass from the model, and the model is a view model that is coming from the view, and then adding to the bus. Now, what is the implementation of the bus here? The bus, in this case, is a command bus for the emergency event. And the way it is implemented is with an improc command bus with a specific instance. And if we jump into it, we'll see that the way it is implemented is a list of commands, which is in a queue, and a list of observer, which is in a list of observer of commands. So they basically implementing the observer pattern. Now, what is the big challenge, the big difference here is that instead of executing directly a command, which basically, in our case, will save the event into the database, simple as that, and we are adding to the command bus. Then we have a command handler that looks into the bus, and the command handler is a specific emergency event handler that handles the specific create new emergency event command. And when it does, so when the handle executes, it will do something like go into my repository for queries, go into my command repository, and then read what is the school, create my entity, so this is the entity from, in this case, from Entity Framework, and then save the entity into the repository. The repository are injected at runtime, as using, I think, is using inject for dependency injection, and they are basically coming out here, and here is actually storing into the database. Now, what all this about is basically saying that instead of in the controller saving directly my object into the database, I'm passing through a queue. The same happens also for the event part of it, which very briefly, and then I'll carry on. When the object is created, so it was here, where my object is created, my emergency event, in this case, it will raise an event. The event, again, is another POCO, is another C# class that contains some attributes, the name of the event, the date when it's been created. And this is added again to an event queue and then processed. When the event queue is processed by the process manager, then the process manager defines the next action to do. So the pattern seems a bit complicated or probably not extremely linear, because in a typical MVC application, I would say, okay, as a controller, execute an action, goes at a kind of data layer and, or entity framework or any other ORM, save it into the database, a sequence of steps or linear. The difference here is that we're going through a command that is an object. The command will go into the command bus, and then there is a handler for it, and then an event. The event will go into another queue, and then there is a event handler again for that queue itself. So there are a lot of elements. Why this complexity? Well, the simple answer is because each of these blocks that you see on screen, so each of these colorful screen objects, can be distributed and can be implemented in, say, a containers, in a different node, and not only the entire queue of commands or the entire queue of events can be distributed in a different node of your cluster, but each specific command, as you know, if you remember here in the code, the command that we have created is a specific event. So there is a command, or an event in this case, for each specific action that happens in the application. So potentially, the possibility to create a distribution of commands events is unlimited, or better, as many command bus, as many event bus as actions that you have in your application. So how we can distribute this in a way that we don't go insane, because otherwise we need to create a lot of in-memory objects and it would be extremely difficult to distribute these. We'll do it through Service Fabric. So let me jump into an example of doing this in Service Fabric. Here we go. So the way Service Fabric works, and again, Service Fabric, the beauty of it is that you can run it on any infrastructure. It's actually now running on my laptop. It's a service that you can deploy and install it, and it will execute locally. But obviously, the commodity of it is that you can deploy into Azure and run it there from the cloud and control through the portal. So let me see. In this case, I'm creating a stateful service. No? So we can create a stateless service. It's a normal API, a REST API. Then you just have all the get, post, patch, put verbs that you can define for a RESTful API. Or you can create a stateful service. And we need a stateful service because I need access to a queue of messages that I send in the command bus. It's a reliable queue, it's a specific queue that is implemented in Service Fabric. I just give a name to the queue, obviously. I'm processing commands, so I call it command bus, command queue, whatever. But as you can see, it's a specific type, which is my create new emergency event. So again, a queue for each specific command. When I deploy this stateful service, Service Fabric will allocate automatically to a node of the cluster. So as many services I create, as many nodes I have. And then Service Fabric will also do a replication across different nodes for high availability. When this happens, and this is done as part of a transaction, as you can see, so I call the add method. I will show you how to call it in a moment. I create a transaction. enqueue the message, everything is asynchronous, and then commit. If something wrong happens, then obviously all the changes are discarded. When the queue runs, so there is a new message in the queue, I create another transaction, and then dequeue the message, and then handle the message itself. And the message will be handled in the same way that we have seen before. So we have a specific command, and then here I will create my entity, as I was doing before in here. It's the same handle method. It's just not implemented in this case, but basically in the handle of the command, you do all your specific action to the command. Typically, you will save the entity into a database, but it can be anything. You can send an email, an SMS message, is a log file, is you're handling your command. So whatever that requires, saving into the database, and so on. So the process is the same. So at the end, what I have to do in my initial controller, instead of calling an in-memory command bus, which is creating an in-memory queue, all I need is a cloud command bus. So I'll comment this, is a cloud command bus, extremely, very simple, instance, and then I can do the add or the add async, and add my command again. So by replacing my in-memory with a cloud command bus, I'm basically using Service Fabric automatically. And the cloud command bus is implemented here. You need a few NuGet packages, so just let me give a pointer. So you need these guys here, Microsoft.ServiceFabric, .data, and .services. So these are all the packages for then creating a command bus that subscribe to the service that we have deployed in Service Fabric, and then post asynchronously the message. So the big advantage of Service Fabric here is really giving the possibility to shift all our infrastructure, to deploy our infrastructure in the cloud, and basically forgetting about it. We don't have to manage the different nodes and then distribute, okay, this service will go into node 1, this other service into node 2, and then I have to run an IIS server here or another host there. Service Fabric does this for us. It's a cluster. I'll create services, I'll deploy the services to my Service Fabric cluster, and it will just distribute all the services to all the different nodes. Okay, so event hosting, yes, we have seen this. Very briefly, the stateless services, I will probably just fly over this slide very quickly, but you do your REST API, and you have to take care of the storage itself. If there is a storage, if there is a persistency in your API, is something that in a stateless service you have to take care personally, as in you do have to do it in a code level. You can still use queues, the reliable queue or dictionary, or list also, so there is iReliable queue, iReliable dictionary, and iReliable list that you can use, but has to be explicitly used in the stateless service. A stateful service instead will allocate automatically the storage and persist without doing any coding specifically. So it's typically stored in DocumentDB, if I'm not wrong, because they're all serialized objects, so you will typically serialize using JSON, but not necessarily, and then they will be stored into a NoSQL database. But a stateful service provides this basically automatically. It's a good advantage. And that's pretty much it in terms of the full picture. Just want to make a reminder, Microsoft obviously provide all the services in Azure. Not everybody use the free capability of allowance of Azure that comes with MSDN. So if you are on MSDN, consider that you have how much? $200 a month of free services. Service Fabric is not cheap. It's not free, but it's cheap. Service Bus instead is free. So there is a free tier that you can run, I don't honestly remember, but thousands of messages for free before you move into the next tier, and then there is a charge for it. Service Bus, so that was the previous demo that we have seen, only the queue and the topics. Service Fabric instead has a cost because there is infrastructure that is deployed. So there are containers and it is not purely platform, is not purely a serverless platform. Continue your learning path. As said, yesterday there was a very nice session about CQRS. If you missed it, have a look into the recording as soon as they are published. And then they will be published on Channel 9 in the next weeks. And on the Virtual Academy, there are a couple of nice videos around implementing Service Fabric. If you have the patience to go through all of them, they show a bit more of some code examples. All the codes and slides that you have seen today will be available online for download, so no worries about it. Tonight is the Spark After Dark night, so come along. If you rate this session, you have a chance to win. Remember to collect your wristbands. I'm doing the due diligence at the end, so don't shoot the messenger. And that's it. Questions, doubts, fears. Okay. Yes. Which one should I use? That's a good point. Microsoft has open source now all of the containers implementation. So that is a good way to consider for the future. The difference that is at the moment is that Service Fabric hides the complexity of deploying containers. And you basically don't have to deal with any networking things or with any other allocation of services to each container. It does it for you. Is really the glue between infrastructure and platform. Is infrastructure, but deployed as a platform. Containers, you have full control of the containers, Dockers, or the other one. Obviously, if you are more of a network person or more infrastructure person, you will feel more in control of what happens using the lack of Dockers. Or the new implementation that is coming in Azure. All right, any more questions? Is the chocolate done, finished? You finished all the chocolate, Matt. Well done. Excellent. All right, thanks. Oh, yes, yeah, sure.
Service Fabric seems to be, it's a big buy-in.
Yeah. Very true.
And now we've also got the option of using Azure Functions.
Serverless functions completely. Yep.
Tying that probably ties in well with the Service Bus kind of an option. Have you got any ideas of what you would say, what kind of projects suit which different implementations?
So look, personally, I like the implementation of the Service Bus with functions or with web stateless web API. So try it. I like the cleanness of code that you generate. All the endpoints are separate. It's not. It is a first step towards a microservice architecture, with the advantage of having the service bus in the middle, not as a service bus per se. as in containing all of the data mapping and all the data transformation. I don't like that because then you tend to centralize something that should otherwise doesn't scale. But I use the service bus more as a kind of gateway, you know, as a more connection between all the different points. It gives me queuing, it gives me workflows, and one central point for security. Instead of securing each API, I can just all go in there. They're all behind the firewall, they're all protected, so they don't. I don't need to secure and authenticate all of them. I just do it from outside, from the external application, but that goes inside the service bus. So the pattern of the publish, subscribe using a service bus in a clean way is what I see easier to implement without even going towards a CQRS and a high scalability, high distribution. Now, you know the old saying, if you distribute an application, you have a problem of performance, and now you have a problem of distribution. So try not distribute if you can. Obviously, Service Fabric makes easier to distribute, but it comes with a overhead or cost. I don't even know the performance because we haven't run into production with Service Fabric to see the volume. But the service bus is fantastic. Millions of transactions with very, very low latency. You go. Yes, with an API management application in Azure as well. Microservices are not necessarily API, but if you put an API on top of microservice, you can then reuse it. The concept of the microservice is that it does one thing and it does well. It doesn't necessarily have to be reused. The concept of being reused was the old SOA, but the service-oriented architecture, but is not necessarily a requirement for a microservice. A microservice is do one thing and do it well, and then be deployed in containers, these kind of things. If you put an API hat on it, and then you use an API management platform, then you also introduce reusability of the microservice itself. So yes, totally. Depends. So if you're talking about versioning, if you're talking about the life cycle of the API, do it in the API management, not at the ESB level. The Azure Service Bus doesn't even offer that. It works in combination with API management. Service Fabric does, actually. Service Fabric, you can do the full versioning because you can deploy a different version of the service in different containers, in different nodes. It does the versioning, so it maintains the application life cycle. It helps on that. Between the two, is always down to personal skills at the end. Again, with Service Fabric, you're moving towards more of a container, a pure microservice architecture. Service bus and API management, as we have seen, is an alternative way to do application, but not necessarily to distribute. So, yeah, the two things. All right. Thanks, everybody. I will be around, and you can always find me on online. And I have another session tomorrow morning at 11. Talking about Azure Redis and machine learning. Anybody's interested? I'll be around. See ya.